Have you ever dreamed a dream that seemed so real that when you woke up it seemed like it's something that actually was? I think most of us have at one time or another. I want to talk a little bit this morning about a dream. Back in Genesis chapter 37, it says, "And Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. They were his brothers, his own flesh and blood." Their hatred began, though, earlier than this dream. We have to go back just a little farther over in Genesis 37 and verse 4, because it says, "And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him." You see, Jacob, Joseph's father, had special feelings for Joseph, and it was that Joseph was born to him in his old age. And over in Genesis 37 and verse 3, it says, "Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors." Well, Joseph told his brothers about this dream that he had, and I'm sure it seemed so real to Joseph, and he shared this dream with it, and he said, "Behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheave arose and stood upright, and your sheaves stood round about and were obedient unto my sheaves." Well, for his brothers that already hated him for being the pick of his father's eye, it even brought more hatred in their heart for their brother Joseph. They were more upset with him, and they said to Joseph in a roundabout way, "Are you implying that you are going to reign over us, that you'll have dominion over us, and that we'll have to bow down to you?" And over in Genesis 37 and 8, it says that his brothers hated him even the more for his dream and his words. Well, it came to pass that Joseph had another dream. And in this other dream, he told his brothers that the sun and the moon and the 11 stars would be subject unto him. And his father Jacob, the Bible says, rebuked Joseph and said, "Indeed, your family come to bow down to you." And we're told later that his brothers envied him and that his father observed the saying. I think his father came to believe it, but his brothers hated him more after this second dream. And it turns out that Jacob sent Joseph's brothers to a town called Shechem, and he sent the herd, the flock, with them, and they were to find proper pasture for the flock and let them graze, and told his brothers to make sure all of that got done. And after they had gone, Jacob decided to send Joseph when time had passed to check on his brothers. And he told Joseph, "When you find out how they're doing and what's going on with them and the flock, come back and let me know how they're doing." So Joseph went off to Shechem and was wandering around in a field, the Bible says, trying to find his brother and the flock. Now, I want you to keep in mind that at this time, Joseph was only 17 years old, and his father sent him to a far land to find his brothers that were off grazing this herd. Well, this certain man found him and wanted to know who he was looking for. And Joseph explained to him that he was trying to find his brothers and their flock. And this man said, "Well, I know who you're talking about." Said, "They're not here. They have gone to a place called Dothan." And so Joseph left, and he went to this town called Dothan. And I want you to keep in mind that Joseph's brothers really, really hated him. Can you imagine hating your brother so much that you would want to kill him? that you would want to take his life. Well, that's how much they hated Joseph. They wanted to take his life. They had that much hatred in their heart for him. And over in Genesis 37 and verse 18, it says, "And when they saw him afar off, even before he came near unto them, they conspired against him to slay him. Not one of his brothers, but all of his brothers from afar off, when they saw him, conspired to kill him, to do away with him." They hated him that much. But one of his brothers saved him from being killed. Reuben told the others, said, "Look, let's just throw him in the pit. Let's just throw him in this pit and not kill him." And Reuben thought that he might be able in some way to maybe come back and rescue Joseph and take him back to his father Jacob. He didn't like the idea of taking his brother's life. But in the meantime, a group of Midianite traders came by. And his brothers decided, "Hey, we're not going to kill him. Let's just sell him to these Midianite traders. So they sold him for 20 pieces of silver. Joseph was taken off to Egypt and eventually sold there. But his brothers made up a pact. What that amounted to was that they made up a lie to tell their father Jacob. What they did was keep Joseph's coat. You remember that coat that his father made him that we read about, that coat of many colors? Well, they took this coat because they knew that their father would recognize who this coat belonged to, and they killed a young goat, and they dipped Joseph's coat of many colors in that blood, and they took that coat back to their father, and they lied and told their father that they had found the coat, and they knew not what had happened to Joseph. Well, his father knew that it was Joseph's coat and said that an evil beast must have killed him and devoured him. Jacob mourned. He tore his clothes for many days over his son. His other children tried to console him, tried to comfort him, but he said, "I'll go to my grave. I'll go to my grave mourning the loss of Joseph." Well, these Midianite merchants, these Midianite traders, eventually got to Egypt. They sold Joseph to a man named Potiphar, who was an officer of Pharaoh's, who was actually a captain of the guard. And Joseph's brothers forgot and didn't count on one thing when they sold Joseph off to these traders. And that one thing was that, as Genesis 39 and verse 2 says, "And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian." They did not count on the Lord being with Joseph when they sold him off and pretended and told his father that he must have gotten killed. This Potiphar right away saw that the Lord indeed was with Joseph, and all that he did was good. All that he did, he prospered from. And the Lord blessed Potiphar even for being such a good man to Joseph. And Potiphar put Joseph in charge of all that he had. He was like second in command under Potiphar, what Potiphar was over. However, Potiphar had a wife that looked upon Joseph and made several advances towards Joseph, and Joseph refused to give in to her advances, and it made her so mad that she went to Potiphar and said, "Look, your servant Joseph has tried to get his way with me," said, "you have to do something about it." Well, this woman's husband, Potiphar, believed what his wife had said and threw Joseph into prison. Well, Joseph was in this prison, and keep in mind, not for anything that he did. He didn't do anything to get there, but Joseph was in prison. He had an opportunity to interpret a dream. And what that amounts to is telling someone what their dream means. He had two people there, a butler and a baker, who were actually the butler and the baker for Pharaoh, who was the king of Egypt. The interpretation of the butler's dream was that he would be restored back to the king's service. However, the baker wasn't so lucky. The dream that he had, the interpretation was that he was going to be hanged on a tree. Well, both of these interpretations came to pass, and Joseph told the butler, said, look, when you get restored back to the king, put in a good word for me so that maybe I'll get restored back to my job. However, the butler didn't. He got his restoration back to Pharaoh, and he left all of the prison behind him. He didn't remember Joseph and the interpretation of the dreams. 2 years passed by, 2 whole years Joseph stayed in that prison, and Pharaoh had a dream. And he called all of his magicians in, all of the wise men of Egypt to interpret his dream. But guess what? No one could interpret this Pharaoh's dream. Then the butler remembered, hey, I was in prison with a guy that interpreted my dream and another dream for the butler. Or a baker, I'm sorry. And he said his name was Joseph. So they brought Joseph out, and Pharaoh asked him, says, I understand that you can interpret dreams. Can you interpret my dream? And Joseph told him that God could interpret his dream. And then Pharaoh told Joseph his dream, and Joseph told him, says, God has interpreted your dream, and I'll tell you how God has interpreted it. He said there would be a horrible famine that would last for 7 years. He said, but before this famine, there's going to be 7 great years for crops, and that to get through this horrible 7 years of famine, that Egypt is going to have to lay by and store off of the proceeds of these good 7 years in order to make it through those 7 years of bad, and that God would surely cause this thing to happen, which he did. But Pharaoh was so pleased with Joseph and his interpretation, and that God allowed Joseph to interpret or give Joseph this interpretation, that Pharaoh said the Spirit of God was with Joseph. He marveled at how God blessed Joseph and how God was in Joseph's life, and Pharaoh put Joseph in charge of Egypt, answering only to him. So this means that Joseph was over the whole nation of Egypt, except the Pharaoh had more power than him. And not only did he put him in charge, it says that Pharaoh put a ring on his finger, which actually signified that he had brought him into his family. He had given him all that there was to give him, except for what he actually had. Clothed him with the finest things that money could buy, and put him in charge of all the land in Egypt. Now, I want you to keep in mind, at this time, Joseph was 30 years old. So there'd been quite a few years passed by since his brother sold him, and he ended up in prison, and now he was back in charge of all the land in Egypt. But at 30 years old, Joseph took himself a wife, and the scripture says that he had two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. And during this 7 years of plenty under the direction of Joseph, because he was in charge of everything, that Egypt stored up enough corn to not only get Egypt through this famine for the 7 years, but to sell food to other nations that were affected by this great famine as well. Back in the land of Canaan, now that's back where Joseph and his family originally lived, they were dying because of lack of food. The famine was great there. Jacob had heard that Egypt had corn, and he decided to send Joseph's brothers to Egypt to see if they could buy some corn to bring back as to ease the famine, to ease the family, and so that they would live and not die. And over in Genesis 42 and verse 2, it says, and he said, behold, I have heard that there is corn in Egypt. Get ye down thither and buy for us, thence that we may live and not die. The famine was a great famine. So 10 of Joseph's brothers, older than him, came to Egypt to buy food. They came and bowed down before Joseph, as now he was the governor over the land of Egypt. And you have to remember back to that first dream now, where Joseph said that his sheaves would rise up and his brother's sheaves would bow down and be obedient to him. Well, this has come to pass because now his brothers are in front of him bowing down and asking permission to buy food from Egypt. They did not recognize Joseph. They didn't recognize his brothers, but Joseph recognized them immediately. He recognized who they were, but he kept it a secret. And he told his brothers, he said, "Surely you must be spies. You must be spies from another country coming to see how the land of Egypt has been made naked, made barren because of all of the lack of food and this famine." Of course, they denied it because they weren't spies, but Joseph went on and said, "Okay, I want you to prove it. I want you to go back and get your younger brother, that your words may be proved." Because they, in their talking, they had told Joseph that they had all came except one, a younger brother. So Joseph said, "Okay, I want you to go back and get him, that it may be proved that you're not spies." Actually, Joseph was just wanting to see his brothers and wanting to make sure that they were okay, and having his brothers go through this thing. So Joseph put all of his brothers in this holding place, the scripture says, so they could decide which one or who was going to go back and get the other brother. But after 3 days, Joseph decided for himself that he was going to send someone back to get the younger brother. And what he decided was he was going to let all of them go back except for one, Simeon. And he was going to be left behind as sort of insurance that they were going to come back. And when the brothers returned home to their father, they explained to him what had happened and that the governor of Egypt had wanted them to do certain things and wanted to come back and bring his younger brother back so that they would prove that they weren't spies. And Joseph, or Jacob, said, I've lost Joseph. Said, he's dead and gone. He said, now they have Simeon. He's gone. And you want to take my next youngest son, Benjamin? He said, everything is against me. Said, I'm going to lose 3 sons. Said, I can't allow that to happen. Said, you can't do it. You can't take Benjamin away. But the famine continued, the scripture says, and their food once again ran low, and they were afraid of dying. And Jacob said, look, to his sons, I want you to go back to Egypt. I want you to buy more food so that we can live. And Reuben said, but father, we can't go back without Simeon. We won't be able to buy food. And Reuben told his father, okay, let me take Simeon, get some food, and then I'll bring your sons back. He said, if I don't bring them back, said, then you can kill my 2 sons. Whew, that's a heavy promise, isn't it? If I don't fulfill what I'm going to say, you kill my children. That's a heavy, heavy promise. But Jacob told his sons, okay, if it must be, it must be. We have to have food or we're going to die. He allowed the older sons to return to Egypt with the younger son. And when Joseph saw that his older brothers had come back with the younger brother, he invited them to dine in his personal home with him. His brothers were afraid because they were being taken to the governor's house, that something was up, that something was wrong. Joseph questioned his brothers about his father, and they told him that their father was still in good health, that he was aging, but he was still alive and in good health. When Joseph saw his brother Simeon, the scripture says he had to leave the presence of his brothers and wept because he was so overcome. by seeing his brother. But on returning, he dined with them and instructed the steward of the house. Now, this is the steward of Joseph's house. He's second in command. Now, keep in mind, he's like the governor. He instructed. He's not done with his brothers yet. He's trying to teach them a lesson and trying to bring back to their mind and thought of the things that they had done in the past. But he told his steward of the house, he said, fill all their sacks that they brought with food, but I want you to do something else. I want you to place my gold or silver cup in the sack of Benjamin. I want you to plant the silver cup that I use in Benjamin's sack. So the steward of the house did exactly what Joseph said, filled their bags with food, and he planted that silver cup in Benjamin's bag. And Joseph instructed the steward that after his brothers had gone and on their journey back towards Canaan, that he was to overtake them and catch up with them and to search the bags and see who the bag was that had the silver cup and to bring him back, and he was going to be his servant. Of course, the cup was found in Benjamin's sack because that's what Joseph had instructed his steward to do. And they all returned back to the city where Joseph talked to Benjamin and said, look, do you have a father or do you have any other brothers? And he was wanting to get the reaction of Benjamin to see if he would admit to ever having a youngest brother named Joseph. You know, because Joseph realized who they were. They still didn't know who he was. And, of course, his brother admitted that his father was an old man, and the brother of my father's eye is in his old age, that he had in his old age, is dead. Because he figured by now that Joseph was probably sold off into slavery and was killed and is dead and gone. And it was safe to say that, you know, he's dead. He's gone. And Benjamin told Joseph, look, if we return without Simeon, our father will die of a broken heart. He's already lost one son that he said he was going to grieve unto death for. If we return without Simeon, he's surely going to die of a broken heart. Genesis 44 and 31 says, it shall come to pass when he seeth that the lad is not with us, that he will die, and thy servant shall bring down the gray hairs of thy servant, our father, with sorrow to the grave. Well, at this point, Joseph could not refrain any longer. He burst into tears in the presence of Reuben and his brothers, and he had the workers leave the room, and he spent time alone with his brothers. And during this time, he announced to them that, look at me, I'm your brother Joseph. I'm the brother that you sold into slavery. I'm the brother that you wanted to kill, that you hated. They were astonished, to say the least, and then they grew afraid because they didn't know what to expect because of the evil that they had done to Joseph. I mean, here Joseph is the governor. He could have them killed in an instant. He could have them immediately removed and killed. But Joseph said, be not grieved. God sent me before to preserve life. The famine has been 2 years ongoing. It had been that 7 years they had prepared and stockpiled food. They're 2 years into the famine. There's still 5 years of this great famine left. He told his brother, says, go get my father. Tell him his son Joseph is alive and is made governor, made lord over Egypt. Go down and get him and hurry. Don't waste any time. Just go. And so his brothers went down, and they were instructed to bring the family members back, children, their flocks, their herds, and they were going to come back and live in Egypt. It says, I will nourish thee, for there's yet 5 years of this terrible famine left. Well, Pharaoh heard about what was happening, and he told Joseph, said, look, I'm behind you 100%. Send your brothers to get your family, and they can have all the good of the land. He'd take their pick of the land, have the best land that's available in Egypt. Pharaoh supplied all the wagons, all the provisions for Joseph's brother to go back and get the family and to bring them back. When the brothers returned to Jacob and told him that Joseph was alive, and I just imagine, and we're not told, that they had some explaining to do since Joseph was alive and how he was governor over Egypt. But the scripture says that Jacob said, I will go and see him before I die. So they got all loaded up and they got ready to head back to Egypt, and he did. They returned to Egypt, and under Pharaoh's guidance, Joseph was allowed to care for his family and his father. And we're told that Jacob was able to be with Joseph for 17 years before he passed away. So he had a great, great blessing to be back with Joseph, the son that he thought was dead and gone, for 17 years. You look at this story and you see the hand of God at work throughout this whole story. What a wonderful homecoming it was for all of Joseph's family. You know, it could have been terrible. They could have all died if Joseph hadn't been sold into slavery and this great famine had come upon the land. They could have all died. Yet, you see the hand of God in the workings, how Joseph was not killed. He was sold to slave traders and then sold to Potiphar and then in prison, interpreted the dream for Pharaoh and put in as governor of over Egypt. But you know, the best part about this whole story is that Joseph harbored no ill towards his brothers. He was willing to forgive. He loved them in spite of the bad things that they had done. He gave them a wonderful home, despite all that they had done. Can you see the parallel between this story and the story that we have today between us and God? God loves us even when we've done bad, just as Joseph loved his brothers when they've done bad. God loves us even when we've done bad. But he's provided a way for us, just as God's hand was in this story about Joseph and his family and providing a way. God's provided a way for us, and he gives us the hope of a wonderful homecoming. And I want to tell you what a day of homecoming it'll be. And it's good to look out and see familiar faces and people you know and love that have come home, that have worshiped here at Central before. But what a day of homecoming it'll be when we get to heaven. What a wonderful homecoming. God loves us even when we're bad. He's provided a way through his dear son to give us this wonderful homecoming. But we must be obedient to the Word of God to be in the family of God. We're to hear the Word of God. We're to believe it. We're to be repentful, confess Christ as the Son of God, and of course be baptized for the remission of sins. I hope if you're here today and you don't have that hope of heaven, you don't have that hope and recognition of that wonderful homecoming one day, that you would want it, that you would want to be a part of it. You can do that today by becoming a child of God today. If you're a Christian and you're here today and you've faded and drifted away from God, there's no better time for you to be restored back to God than today. If we can help you today in any way, whether it's obeying the gospel or coming back home, let us stand and sing this song of encouragement. And if you have a need, please, please respond.